sometimes you need it from other people, but in this sport, you better be able to do it yourself, I think.
Yeah, you're always looking for a spark. Sometimes there's... It's from the verbal and the cheering, and sometimes a key base hit, maybe an error by the opposing team.
The Atlantic Coast Conference, for all of its success, and Miami is obviously a recent member, Florida State, a new member but less recent. And the last title, the only title, Wake Forest, 1955. And I'm sure nobody in the Atlantic Coast Conference thought then it would be the last time that they would win a World Series. But right now, Eric Davis, the senior out of Mountain View, California, has got to feel good about his chances, because all he has to do is not give up bases on balls, not hit people, just make them hit their way on.
Now, this is a perennial power, and this Miami offense does have the potential to come back. And you don't want to set the table for him. You want to play solid defense. Don't walk anybody. You're going to have to make some quality pitches, too, to get through this lineup.
They have hit the second most home runs that any Miami team ever has. But right now, their big sticks are not coming through in the clutch. Runners in scoring position has been a nightmare of a statistic for this team. Jackson, line to left, flew to center. Had a great sophomore year at shortstop. He's 5-for-10 here in the College World Series and hitting 360 overall. He'll be a stalwart for them next year as well. Pops this one down the right side. And caught in fair territory by Gerhardt. One out. There is a tremendous bias, of course, to Western and Southern teams because of the weather. My partner played at Bowling Green, which certainly is a weather-challenged program in Ohio. But this is exactly what you can expect to have. The NCAA is trying to make it more equitable, they think, by delaying the start of the season. And most of the good Northern teams come down here, stay for a week, 10 days, and try to play every day. But it's still, kids want to come to Southern clubs because it's just nicer weather for baseball.
They want to play in the nicer weather. You're less apt to get hurt because you're going to be in a little better shape than playing on the grass or the field turf. Warmer weather.
I mean, I remember
you're
growing
guaranteed
up in West
to not
Virginia.
Maybe get rained out as much or snowed out.
Yeah. Anything above 45 was baseball weather for us.
Exactly.
You know, so you
at Bowling Green, we got snowed out usually our first two weekends. The games are on the schedule, but we didn't get to play them.
Severino trying to make something happen with one out here against Eric Davis. Raven is next. First two guys with base hits in this ballgame. Ticote let it off. Jamal Weeks followed him with base hits. That's been it. Talk about being shut down. Base on balls, got the starter out of there in the fifth and brought on Davis. As Sandbrink gave way to the senior, he issued a base on balls, but that's it. No hits. Three balls and two strikes to Severino. When it's really quiet in that Miami dugout still. Even with those measly two hits, they've left six guys on base. There's a third. As Severino turns on one and rolls it into right field for a single.
Well, they're looking for a spark. Dennis Raven coming up next. Got the lucky Mohawk for offense. He's been outstanding defensively. High fastball just finds a hole. Get the ground ball, but sometimes they're hard enough to get a spot and an opening.
Millville ranged to his right, just couldn't get there.
Yeah.
Draven would love to hit his way on. Has only one base hit here in Omaha, and is now his third game. He really doesn't have to get a hit. With the defense he's played in right field, he has just been sensational.
He's 10 home runs this year, four guys in double figures on this team. Two at the top of the order, and Cicotti and Weeks, and then Alonzo in the third hole, and then Draven with 10.
Got a fastball right down the middle and fouled it off. And I'm sure Jim Morris has told him, don't be thinking home run. We don't need home runs right now. We need base hits. You can't hit a six-run homer.
Nope. Base runners grind out at bat, set the table, and let's get some key hits after that.
Swing and a miss. On a 90-mile-an-hour fastball from Davis, it's 1-2. Davis, you have to wonder, when he was getting ready to have that surgery to repair his cheekbones and orbital bones and get his eyesight back, could have dreamed that this is where he would end up, as this one is fouled off.
And he's doing a good job getting down the hill and being aggressive. You don't see any remnants of him being struck by the ball in the face. What a tremendous comeback.
Makes it easy to root for him, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah.
1-2. Could be two. To second for one on to first. Double play. Miami is gone in the sixth. And it's 7-1 Stanford as they inch closer to staying alive and eliminating Miami. Right now, they are really down, and their fans really quiet. Why not? They're down by 7 here in the seventh.
Well, starting back in the third, you give up 2 runs. Then the fourth, you give up 1. Fifth, you give up 4. Sixth, you give up 1.
If you only scratch out 3 hits, that'll get to you. Now they'll start with the number 8 man in the order, Haggerty, against veteran Eric Davis, who has been really good since he came on in relief and stands to be the winning pitcher in this one. Haggerty walked, flew out to right. Big-time player in Missouri. One of 2 Missouri kids to go to the Miami program.
The Stanford pitchers have done a great job today of changing speeds. The changeup and the split have been very key against this Miami lineup. They've been able to throw enough fastballs on the inner half of the plate to establish that side. And then, there you go right there, you pull that one foul, 82 miles an hour. Even though it was a mistake and it was up, it was off speed, it was 10 mile an hour off the 92 to 89 mile an hour fastballs. Hitting's about timing, pitching's about upsetting that timing.
And you need that kind of difference, 10, 11, 12 miles an hour between pitches, right?
Yeah, in big games, opening days, playoff games, elimination games, the slow speeds seem to be the pitch that gets people. Because you think about the adrenaline, being anxious, you know, the excitement of a big game.
Sure.
Now all of a sudden you can pull the string on a pitch as a pitcher. You can use what the hitter thinks is big time emotion, adrenaline, strength, quickness against him.
All psyched up and ready to go. But then you hear about pitchers having the same situation where they're psyched up, maybe overthrown.
Then you overthrow. But if you can back off and use what the hitter feels is his strength against him, then the battle of the emotions goes your way.
And you just saw that on that last pitch, an off-speed pitch that dropped out of the zone, and Haggerty struck out. They have come back one time from a 7-run deficit. That was against Florida Atlantic. And with all due respect, this is not Florida Atlantic. Ratliff looks up, and that one is gone. Grandal, the catcher, with his seventh home run. A bomb to dead center. Ratliff hoping it would catch part of the wall and come back to him. But Grandal ought to raise the spirits just a little bit with that shot.
When it first left the bat, I didn't think it was going to be a home run. I thought it was going to be a deep fly ball. And then you continue to watch Ratliff go back. See the swing here. Nice swing right there, firm right side. He thinks he got it. If you see the pace of Ratliff, and then all of a sudden he just looks up. There's some gust going now. You talked about the wind not being a factor, but we're starting to get a little breeze because some clouds are coming in around.
See Cody trying to bunt his way on. Grandal makes it a six-run ball game and keeps Miami's hopes alive. And see Cody, another Missouri product, trying to get on. He has walked twice and singled. So he's 3-for-9 in Omaha with really good speed.
Well, the big thing here for Miami is this is the part of their order that has produced throughout the College World Series, these first three hitters. And if they can produce this time around the order, they'll get up again in the ninth.
Yep.
So there's a chance to hit around. These guys get two at-bats if they can be successful in these first at-bats at the end of this game.
Davis, 2-1 now. And if these two guys can get on and Alonso can get out of his slump, he struck out three times tonight. Only takes one to hit the big bomb. But these guys have to get on in front of them to give them an opportunity.
Again, we see the changeup, 83 miles an hour. A little out in front.
Davis is another one of those guys. As soon as you see him, you realize he's got a really good idea on how to pitch. Struck him out. So for the first time tonight, they get to Cody. Two strikeouts in the inning for Jamal Weeks.
You know, changeups are great when you can change speeds, but when you have an arm action of a fastball, you see how quick that arm is coming through, and then he slides off the ball. Just comes off his fingertips so that arm speed doesn't get into the baseball. It goes into the spinning of the baseball, not the velocity of the baseball.
Strike called on the inside corner to Weeks. He popped up trying to bunt the last time up. Sacrificed on a bunt the time before that and bunted for a base hit his first trip. They're doing everything he can to use that speed. Ooh. Davis plunked him right in the middle of the back.
He's on first.
He'll take it. That's what they need, base runners. That's his dad. If you hadn't heard the story, he gives the play-by-play on the phone to Jamile's blind grandfather.
Inside fastball, caught him in the back. Inside fastball. Yeah.
Richard working on his reporting skills. Now with Weeks on, Yonder Alonso, 24 home runs, three off the national lead, and tried to cut into that lead right there with a big rip.
Well, he's going to have to take a deep breath here and take inventory about why he's been making outs. The balls have been away and they've been soft. He's going to have to think about taking the ball to left field, which he has done throughout the year. Give it in to the home run to the right field wall and thinking about driving it to the left center gap.
He has struck out three times in this game.
They are just going to show him fastballs in off the plate. They're not going to give him anything hard inside. They don't want him to hit the ball to right field for power. They're going to make him hit the off-speed pitch away to left field.
That's Sobolewski on deck, who would love to atone for his defensive lapses at third. Three balls and a strike. Make it 2-1, excuse me, to Yonder Alonso.
Now, if he pops one here, we have a ball game. 8-4, and this part of the lineup will come back around by the ninth.
Got a fastball, rips it inside the line, fair. Weeks around third, and they will hold him and hold Alonso to a single. But the big guy gets off the schneid tonight with a base hit and puts runners at first and third for Sobolewski.
He did finally get something inside. It was kind of a mistake. He rolls over it, but he drives it down the line. Millville gets a glove on it just to flex it.
I think it came up a little more than Millville expected, and he was able to get a piece, but that was all. And good hustle by Gerhardt to go over there and dig it out. Now Sobolewski, he has struck out twice tonight and had two tough plays down to third that cost his club. There's a fastball for a strike. No action in the Stanford bullpen. Sobolewski 1-for-10 in the College World Series. This one will get away from catcher, but Castro recovers quickly. Weeks will stay at third. Alonso goes down to second. Four of 25 with runners in scoring position, and even more deflating, 14 strikeouts tonight. 1-for-8 with 5 strikeouts. Now Castro wants to go talk to Davis.
A little chat here, make sure we're on the same page. You also have a runner on second. I think that's what it was. What sign are we going to use with the runner on second? Very quick, let's go. You know, first sign after two, second sign.
One to Sobolewski, the sophomore from Sarasota. Big situation for him. Popped off the right side. Millville giving chase, but it's about 10 rows back in the stands. Infield is back. They don't care about the runner at third. They want the out. So does Davis to get out of this jam.
He hasn't really shown a sharp breaking ball. There's really no risk, I don't think, for a wild pitch or a fastball again. I think he can get away with the fastball well located or the changeup.
A ball and two strikes. Walking a guy here, not necessarily a bad thing.
Now you want to keep him in the ballpark. Give him the base hit. You want to keep him in the ballpark.
It's a straightaway right. Gerhardt is there to make the catch. Sobolewski can't deliver. And Miami is running out of outs. We'll go to the bottom of the seventh. It is 8-2. And we want to welcome in Dave Dare, who has been our stage manager 25 years. Dave has been working the College World Series. That's hard to imagine.
25 years.
And he's been working years and years with us in football, so we got you this. Dave Dare, 25 years of service to College World Series on ESPN. Man, it's pretty nifty, isn't it?
That's very nice. Thank you very
Thank
much.
You, David.
From the whole crew.
Pleasure.
Way to go.
Our crew came up with that idea. I think it was a wonderful, wonderful job, guys.
Now it's raining on his parade.
Just don't let the trophy get wet. I'm not sure that's the highest quality medal we've got. That might bleed a little bit.
How many years has this been for you?
15? I have no idea. No clue.
No clue.
No. Nope.
What was the score of yesterday's game?
No clue. I'm just like you. The game's over. I don't know.
I don't know.
I can look it up.
Exactly.
That's the beauty of it. Now it's getting to be do or die time for Miami, and Ryan Jackson says, let's do. Rip that one back up the middle. Time now for our Coke Zero game track. Yeah, Jackson shoots one back up the middle. 1-for-9 is Miami with runners in scoring position. That's why they are down by 6. Ratliff, a 2-run homer, a bomb to right center. And this, of course, an elimination game. The winner goes on to play Georgia on Friday, trying to stay alive again. The loser has to take that trip home. And for both, or either, it will be a long trip home since we're in the middle of the country. This one is ripped by Severino. So the first two have reached for Miami, and both ripped it. So Davis may be trying to get ahead with that first pitch fastball, and they're going up there thinking this may be the best pitch I get to hit in this at bat.
See, it was a fastball or changeup. I'm not sure. Maybe a high changeup. The last one was a fastball. You're right, Mike. And right here, they are deciding, you know what? We're not going to take. If he's going to lay it in there and they don't want to walk us, we're going to attack. Working the count hasn't worked for us, so let's get aggressive.
Jackson at second, Severino at first for Rabin. Hit into a double play his last time out. He has been the defensive star of this series. Now he wants to be the offensive star, and he rips one to dead center field for a base hit. Ratliff comes up throwing. Bases loaded. Nobody out. 3 straight ringing singles, and all at once, the Hurricane offense, which has been slumbering for the better part of 3 games, has come alive. And Mark Marquez says, oh, let's get somebody heated up in a hurry. Storen, the closer, is up. It's well time to stretch it out a little bit and get ready.
We'll have a visit from the catcher, Jason Castro. That'll be a little delay. We might get a visit from a pitching coach. That'll be a delay. But anything to get Storen some time to get loose.
There has not been, Oral, a grand slam in the College World Series since 2001. Don't know if Haggerty is aware of that statistic. Coffey of the Georgia Bulldogs 7 years ago. And here comes Mark Marquez. Not going to make a pitching change here because this guy Storen just started throwing. But he's going to go out here and give him some time to work as much as he can.
Are you going to trade outs for runs right now?
Yes, sir.
You're going to do that. You're going to play your defense at probably normal depth, maybe a little bit of double play depth up the middle.
Storen just got back to the top of that practice mound in the bullpen for the first time. And as quickly as he might be able to get ready, he's not ready yet. So Eric Davis, the senior, ends up going 2 2/3, giving up 6 hits, 3 of them here in a row, and only 1 run. He's responsible for the 3 runners on right now, struck out 4 and walked only 1. So Jason Haggerty, who has 8 home runs this year, stands in looking for a base hit in this game. He's 1-for-4 in the series. Infield is back. They'd like to turn a double play. They'll give up the run. That's no problem. Haggerty has a grand slam this year. He could cut the lead to 2 with 1 swing. That one's on the corner.
If you're thinking, can Miami string a rally together to get 6 runs over 2 innings? They have 6 guys in their lineup with on-base percentages over 400. Haggerty's is 353.
Very aggressive hitter. Takes this one outside. And Davis, who was just laying it in there, try to get outs. Can't be too picky here. He's got to throw strikes. A ball and a strike to Haggerty. Bases loaded. Nobody out in the Miami eight. That one's low. 2-1. When you were in this situation, go best pitch, best pitch.
Yeah, whatever feels good in your hand right now. It's not always completely about strategy. Since it's about strikes and you've got such a big lead, you want to feel good in your hand, feel like you can execute it, and have some confidence and let it go.
Fastball, 2-2.
I would suspect, because throughout this outing, the changeup has been his out pitch. I would suspect he would go right back to that. He's going to go to the well. If he makes another pitch, he might get him out looking. Because Miami is definitely up on the pattern also.
Eric Davis, their most veteran pitcher, leads the staff in innings pitched this year. He's the guy they want in this situation. That one's fouled out of play.
Well, that was a fastball up and away. No time to be careful if you're a Miami hitter. Let it go. When you're free and easy, the bat is more accurate and more powerful. When you try and guide that bat, that's when you just deflect the ball, pop it up, and ground out.
Eric Davis's father, you don't think this was tough on him? It was a breaking ball foul away. All a family member can do is sit there and keep their fingers crossed and hope for the best for their son. He has already seen the worst that might happen to this young man when he had his face crushed by a baseball last summer. And came back from that. This thing is bombed to right field. Will it be deep enough? It will not. Gerhardt will make the catch. That got a rise out of the Miami fans, but it didn't carry. And it goes as a sacrifice fly for Haggerty to get home a run. But when that left the bat, it looked like it had a chance to be a granny.
Well, he did go to the well with the changeup, got it up a little bit. Haggerty got out in front of it. Got it away just enough. Marquis made a nice visit to the mound. Settle the young man down, get himself an out for his ball club.
That's the first out. Runners at first and third. This is Grendahl, the catcher who had a home run his last time up, his seventh. And then you've got Ticote, Weeks, and Alonzo next.
All who have homered here at the College World Series.
Davis stays on. Missed with a fastball, 2-0.
Interesting pitch right here. 2-0, you give in. Could be 8-6 in a hurry.
Grendahl came into this game only hitting 231 for the year, but he has two hits in the College World Series. Takes that one wide, and it's 3-0. Well, if you're a pitcher, you're remembering the last time he faced him as he hit a home run. But your job is to keep people off of base.
Yep, that memory creeps in, and it kind of wants you to avoid the bat.
Here's the 3-0. Right down the pipe, strike 3-1. Grendahl from Miami trying to rally the Canes. Big cut, but he missed 3-2.
Stanford started Danny Sandbrink. Then they bring in Eric Davis. They wanted this order because they wanted the upperclassmen on the mound at the end of the game when the pressure was at its highest.
That was a pretty good pitch to hit. Rendall had another big hack and didn't get it. 3-2.
Struck him out on a fastball that may have been up and out of the zone.
It's a break for Stanford.
Eric Davis, the last two pitches go strength against strength. I don't care if they're hittable. I'm coming after you. It's man against man. And you know what? I threw a ball, but you swung at it.
When he starts that pitch over the middle of the plate, it's got a lot of run on it to the outside.
Got some nice tail.
Boy, Dad knows his son Eric hanging on by his fingertips right now, and he'll face T. Cody, the leadoff man with all that power, and he takes a big hack at it.
So T. Cody with a base hit, two walks, and a strikeout his last at bat.
But a 13 home run hitting leadoff man. Two of them coming here in the College World Series, and Weeks is on deck. Now, the good news for Davis, if he can quell this rally, he's not going to have to face these top two guys in the ninth.
Well, these guys came around quicker than we thought.
Yeah.
We were looking for a rally in the seventh to get them around in the ninth, and they've got three straight hits on three straight pitches to start this inning, and only have capitalized with a sacrifice fly to get one run.
And they represent the speed at the top of this order. That one's in the dirt. Castro's right there to make sure there's no damage.
They went bing, bang, bong on fastball, changeup, fastball. And then Mark Marquis comes out to the mound. The repertoire Eric Davis has changed since that visit. We've seen breaking balls. We've seen more fastballs and less changeups. And that pitch mix has gotten the Miami hitters back off balance.
1-2 to T. Cody. Runners at first and third. Two out here in the Miami eighth. They've closed the gap to five, and he struck him out on a hook. Yes, sir, son. Dad's applauding. And Miami gets a run, but that's it. They strand two more, and Davis gets out of a huge jam. We go to the bottom of the eighth, and the Stanford Cardinal leads big.
So, EJ, we've designed you a...
And it is your dream to get here. For Miami, the dream only has three outs left. They are down by five. Weeks, Alonso, and Sobolewski, the scheduled hitters, 2-3-4 in the order. Their job is to get on base, and Eric Davis is still on the hill. Right now, he stands to be the winning pitcher. And that would complete a tremendous road back from the young man who shattered his face in the Cape Cod League last summer. Put a period on the year, wouldn't it?
Oh, fantastic. I mean, you see why when his dad last inning cheering the final out wasn't just overly exuberant. He's got it all in perspective.
Yeah.
Just seeing his son out on the mound healthy, win, loss, runs, or outs.
Weeks is up there trying to do anything he can to get on. He faces a 3-0 count right now. Anything on the ground will be an adventure because this kid can fly, and his dad on the phone to his father,
in the middle of the plate right now,
who no longer has his sight, trying to relay all the play-by-play information. There's a fastball in there. Two called. We might wonder why Davis is still in store and the closer had warmed up the last game. Two ways to look at this. Are you going to use up Davis, or are you going to save Storen for further work? Because they got to win two more games against Georgia So I guess if you want to use up Davis here to win this game, that's fine. Storn will be rested.
There you go, Storn, with multiple innings when you get to Friday. I wouldn't be surprised to take the edge off the freshman and let him pitch a little bit. You got the senior on the mound. The experience is something you continue to draw on as long as it doesn't lead to fatigue.
And this was the plan that Mark Marquis had. He wanted to start his freshman Sandbrink. And if he had to go to the bullpen to bring in Davis with all that veteran leadership and his senior experience, Davis upset. He issues a walk here. Now time for our Pontiac game-changing performance. And the evening belongs to Cord Phelps, who nearly hit for a cycle. Had a single in the first, a double in the third, and then a big triple in the sixth. As he was all over that one. Tremendous effort in center field by T. Cody. Couldn't bring it in. So Phelps with three hits. And also hit one to the gap his fourth time up. And now Yonder Alonso, Miami's best hitter at the dish. Singled his last time up after striking out the first three trips to the plate. Alonso, deep and off the wall. Gerhardt couldn't get there. Weeks had to hold up in case it was caught. Runners at second and third. Alonso delivers for a double, and Miami is not going to go quietly.
Under Alonso, two hits tonight have been right down the line of right field. One a ground ball. And this bullet, if it was up in the air, was definitely going to be a home run. Nice effort right there.
His father is on the other end of the phone going, what, what,
and
what?
He's pulling the phone away from his ear because he's yelling. It's got to be hurting.
Well, Storen is up and ready this time. And they have given the signal he is going to come on. Drew Storen, the freshman closer from Brownsburg, Indiana, will tell you about him when we come back. We're in the ninth. Don't go away.
Hey, Eric, just